As a reminder before we get started, martial arts techniques are inherently dangerous. They're designed to cause harm. They're designed to hurt people. These videos are not meant to take the place of a qualified instructor. And practicing and learning on your own without the benefit of help to make sure you're doing things safely can be very dangerous to you, your training partners, and just lead to a lot of needless injuries. So again, use these to enhance your training, to add to your already safe methods of practicing. Tom Sipin from Four Winds Martial Arts in West Dallas, Wisconsin. Today again we have two of our other instructors, Jenny Naval, my son Kaylee Sipin, and what we're going to be doing today is we're going to fill in some of the holds that we've had with our previous training videos. We've done a lot before with the weapons, with basically a stick, long or medium range stick, and we've done it in different ranges. But a couple of things that we haven't filled in is empty hand skills, hands, feet, elbows, and knees, how they're used in conjunction with the weapon, and a short stick. We've done long stick and, as I mentioned, you know, edged weapons. Now, even if you have a stick, you still have an empty hand. You still have another hand a lot of times unless you have two weapons. Even if you have two weapons, you still have your elbows, your knees, and your feet. So we've mentioned before in a lot of things the misconception that people have a lot of times with the Filipino martial arts in that you're learning the stick, you're teaching or training the stick or the knife. And we try to bring that out, that that's not what you're doing. What you're doing is you're educating your hands, your arms, you're educating your body to work in certain ways, to respond to certain angles of attacks. If there's a weapon in your hand, great. If there isn't, you can still respond the same way. So the short tool or your empty hands and elbows kind of bring that in a little bit. Also, even if you have a tool when you're working with weapons, a lot of times you're working on disarming the other person's weapons, limb destructions, joint destructions, and not just your blocking and trapping, but being able to cause more damage with your striking. So we're going to put all that together today. Again, your empty-handed skills and the use, introduction of the short pocket or palm stick. As we start with our empty-handed skills, we take this like building blocks, or just do a couple of the basics so we can see what we're going to be using to build up as we go along. Okay, so in close, most of the time with weapons, because again, changes for a lot of people, strangely, you know, if I'll go in, I'll be doing knife defense, I'll say, okay, we're going to be working on knife defense today. Usually one of the first things I do is we start kicking, and people say, I thought we're doing knife defense. And the thing is, remember that if you have sticks or knives, they're added two. Okay, nothing takes the place of, we add those weapons to the other things that you have. Okay, so, okay, with our basics, okay, what we'll be using is our knees in close. If we're using the reaction side again, the close side, just quick so we can put these together so we have a reference point. Okay, straight knees, okay, angle knees going in towards the thigh. Okay, a little farther back, bend a little bit more, a little farther back, front kicks. Okay, regular front kicks, angle kicks, so you're using your shin coming inside of the person's thigh, leg, or groin to break their balance. Using your shin to angle outside, so we've got an angle in, you've got an angle out, coming again to the knee, the shin, to the knee, the inside of the thigh, into the groin. Okay, so front kick, angle in, angle out, and toe out. Turn just like a front kick, but you're turning your toes out and hitting with your heel, so you've got your front kick, angle in, angle out, toe out. Okay, opening up, going to hands a little bit more. If you're starting with the head as a target, you've got your palm strikes, you've got your vertical punches, which are the same. If you're a little bit closer, you've got your upward elbows, and your front elbows. Now, starting to move out from the head, coming out to the extremities, because a lot with the Philippine martial arts is, you know, not just the head and the body, but also your weapons delivery system, the parts that hold the weapons, okay, the arms. So moving out from the head, using that forearm strike first, okay, coming out, which also is used in a spear, using that forearm to come forward as a striking tool. Your palms towards the shoulders, again, to disrupt their ability to swing. If you're doing any checking with a weapon, anything else coming back, the weapons coming in, having that ability to check that side or check that side as it's coming in to disrupt their attack, either with palms or, again, your vertical punches into the shoulder joint, into the upper pec area, delt, cause a lot of pain and can disrupt somebody's balance and definitely disrupt their ability to attack. Going farther out, the upper arms. Okay, so your palms, the same thing I'm doing here, your palms right up to that mound of the bicep with all the nerves coming through that open and close the hand and control your strength in the hand. Your palm strikes to the upper arms, upward elbow, your elbow strikes to the upper arms, that forearm coming straight through. And now with going straight through, if I can trap or hook at the same time, I can make the brace there. I'm going to have a lot more effect on that strike, whether I'm using palms or whether I'm using that forearm to come right into the bicep or whether I'm using that upward elbow to come into the bicep. Okay, so I'm using almost like a two count there, whether I was hooking and striking, blocking and striking, blocking and striking, hooking and striking, hooking and striking. Body mechanics in, okay, I could be using any of those attacks. And again, the ideas in this range is not just one, but my attacking, which leads into the knees that we went through, or the kicks that we went through, back in the knees, and into locking and different counts that we're going to be working on next. Now we're going to use those basics to transition into some of the trapping and locking and some of the other things that we're doing. Okay, so what we're going to do just to start off with, okay, we're going to work on some different counts, just different tapping counts to build up coordination and follow through is blocking and trapping, blocking and countering, different ranges, different angles. Okay, now a lot with the weapons, okay, is the same thing, is the purpose of block with your lead hand, so trap with your back hand so you can control it, and you can still use your lead or your strong hand to be attacking. So whether it was with the hands or whether it was a stick or if it was a knife, it's the same thing. Using primary hand to do your initial block, use your check to cover it so that it's still controlled, and using your primary hand to be able to come back. Okay, so it's basics of what we call three counts, block, check, counter, with your usually, you know, a lead hand coming across. So start off with just the lead hand. If we're just using the right hand, Kaylee would be going one, two, three. And okay, now we'll start with a back fist high. There's a lot of things that you can use this for, the exact same drill. We're to start with just a back fist high on the right side. So one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. Now, just shifting, because in close range, we want to get not just one side, but he wants to be able to build up the coordination in the other side too. Now, one of the things that works best for coordination is what we call mirror drills. If you have a coordinated side, if you do all with that side and then you wait and you do all with the other side, it's a lot harder, because just like you have a coordinated side, you have an uncoordinated or less coordinated side. With the mirror drills, what happens is if you go back and forth between your coordinated side immediately to your less coordinated side, your body will pick that up a lot faster. So instead of just doing repetitions with his right hand, he's going to shift, not stepping yet, but he's going to shift and go with his left hand. Because with the one hand, that coordination starts coming in. And if he immediately goes with the other side, the coordination develops in the other side. Now, this is your basic three count, which you can see, if you recognize from our previous videos, is the same principle is block, check, counter with your weapons. The exact same thing. Now, same move would be maybe going with a hammer fist down to the body. If his hand is lower, or you know, I'm open lower, he'd be using a low attack. So a hammer fist to the body. It's still the same count. And the exact same thing, he could be using that forearm to move in to my body. Okay, he's blocking and controlling, and he's using the forearm into my body, to my shoulder, to my neck, to my head. Now, if he was a little bit closer, because again, the idea would not be to stand there, because I would not be, as an aggressor to him, it's not expected that I would stand there like this, or that I would just continuously go one, two, one, two, especially if he was hitting me back. What he would be trying to do is close in, do his three count of whatever it is, and then move in and go further, build it up into something else. We're just doing this again for the coordination and getting through. So after he's doing the his moving in and doing his spear or his forearm coming into the chest, okay, switching both sides. Okay, so again, now if he was in closer, he could be using his elbow. He's low, or I'm open low, so his elbow is coming low. So the next thing would be he wants to build up his coordination, and we want to go back and forth a little bit. So on that three count, we can be working with his back fist high. We can be changing it, transitioning to his hammer fist to the body. We could be transitioning to that forearm strike to my chest, neck, or head. We could be transitioning to that elbow if he was closer. And you could be doing the exact same thing if you were doing this with weapons. Now, next thing after a three count would be a four count. Okay, the idea is your body is shifting. Okay, your body is shifting because if you were turning, that next thing that would be coming in would be the opposite hand. Okay, so after your regular three, block, check, your strong hand counters, he'd be turning in and just following up with that other hand to come in. Okay, so block, check, counter, and then the other hand comes in. So one, two, three, four, letting your body turn. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Okay? Now, the next thing would be he's just twisting, which is more practical. But building up coordination, again, and getting body mechanics in, you can do the exact same thing, stepping. So our normal V-step, the same as we do with our weapons training, anything else, he's going to step back so he's out of range, and then step in to range. So we go back through those same drills, but he'll V-step. So starting with that high back fist, he'll step back and forward and switch hands. And I can step or not step, okay? And he can shift this to his hammer fist, to the body. V-stepping, the same thing. He can shift that to his forearm strike. He can shift that to his elbow. And he can shift it to his four count. One, two, three, four. Twisting in. Three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Okay? Now, next thing would be, we call a five count. Now, that's a little different because with most of these other drills, you're trying to develop the coordination right hand, left hand, right side, left side. But there's times that you wouldn't want to rely on that. Again, if you're going back to, you might have a weapon in one side. Okay, so an example of that would be what we call in our five count. Okay, one, two, three is the same, but now instead of following over with normal hand here, one, two, three, I'd be checking with my opposite hand and still using my primary, the same primary hand to do the number five, the fifth attack. So one, two, three, four, five. One, two, three. If I'm over, I go over. If I'm under, I go under. It could be, okay, a punch. It could be upward, uppercut, anything over. It could be an elbow. It could be anything. The other, but the purpose that I mentioned with this is an example, if I had a weapon in my primary hand, because I want to use that, concentrate on that for most of my attacks. So here's an example why that five count stays with the right hand is one, two, three, four, five. 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 So I'm sticking with that five so that I can use the primary weapon for that fifth attack. Now, next thing would be using that six count, just so you understand a little bit more, is the six count is not just opening up for the hands where we're going one, two, three, block, check, counter, block, check, counter, block, check, counter, okay? That six count could be used not just in that sequence, but just as coordination. So just as I was going block, check, counter, block, check, counter, it could be block, counter, counter, block, counter, counter. It's still the six count. I'm still doing the same thing, but instead of one, two on the arms and three is an attack, one, two on the arms and three is an attack, it could be one, two, three, four, five, six, one, two, three, four, five, six, one, two, three, four, five, six, two, three, four, five, six, one, two, three, four, five, six. So again, all you're doing is developing the coordination in so that you can match any angles. And this would go right into locking and passing. So the next thing would be using your three count, one, two, and three, not just as an attack, but as a pass. Now the first thing we'd be going for is a grip on the elbow, just to start for coordination. Again, figure the first step in your drill. Okay, so your block, check, pass it, okay? It's up high, so I'm doing a high pass, and this is what we call blanket the elbow here. I'm getting a grip with my thumb and middle fingers right above his elbow joint, okay? Because it's easier to grab because I can follow it through, block, check, and as I pass it, I can get to that grip on the elbow and then go further with that. So block, check, three is my pass instead of my counter. Now if I can get it to here, notice I'm starting to bring his hand down, I can slide my hand down to his wrist, what we call an escort position. Okay, and I can use that for better control, better movement. I've got him opened up more. I've got his arm extended and exposed more to go on after this. So using it as block, check, counter, blanket, escort. Okay, I'm bringing him down out of position. Block, check, counter, blanket, escort. Bringing it down out of position. Once more. Block, check, pass it to a blanket, escort. Okay, once more. Block, check, pass, blanket, escort. Now, if I've got him in this position, a good follow-up here is I've got that joint, the arm extended, set up to attack on the extremities. Again, just what we started with the basics, that elbow or forearm right up to the upper arm area, the bicep area, okay, where the nerves are. Block, check, pass it, so I've got a grip on his elbow. I follow that with bringing his arm down, which gives me the ability to smash into his arm, work on your limb destruction, okay? One, two, three, and then in. Block check, blanket escort, being able to work on that limb destruction or smashing this so that I'm going to start to eliminate these weapons so we don't just endlessly keep going through the same thing. Okay, a couple more times. Block check, pass, blanket escort, and as I've got it supported with one hand, I've got a brace so I can smash into it with the other side. While I've got him down and exposed, I've got it supported so I can be smashing in, which opens it up real easy for me to follow up with hooking his wrist. And while that joint is already weakened, the arm is already weakened and exposed, I can follow up and give it that second shot to the back. So one, two, pass it, the blanket and escort. Smash the upper arm, come down and hook it, and then smash back just above the elbow. One, two. One, two. And then following that up, again, moving in, one, two, pass, blanket escort, smash, smash. I can just be setting this up either for like a palm heel, a knee strike. What I like to use is basically just a clothesline. I'll just go through, because especially if there's weapons involved, if I don't have control, if I'm passing something and that weapon's maybe still there and I don't have good control over it, maybe I don't have a good enough grip, I have to get out to a safe position or I have to be able to make sure that I've destroyed his ability to come back and immediately counter. So coming in with a clothesline to his neck, his head, his face, just right through is a very effective counter coming in. So just go empty-handed again. Okay, so passing, one, two, boom, just shoot through. Just shoot through the top. Passing, one, two, shoot through the top with that clothesline. Now, a couple other, so this makes an excellent drill, which you can do step by step, just like we did it. Okay, and just feet. One, two, pass, blanket, escort. One, two, pass, blanket, escort. One, two, pass, blanket, escort, elbow smash. One, two, pass, blanket, escort, elbow smash. One, two, pass, blanket, escort, smash, break the arm. One, two, pass, blanket, escort, smash, support, break the arm. One, two, pass, blanket, escort, smash, smash, clothesline. One, two, pass, blanket, escort, smash, smash, clothesline. Okay, obviously I'd be in a good position to follow up with knees, and I can just add that on. Now, a couple other things with that is options that we're in with some of those positions, just so you're aware of them. And again, the options can be built in as part of those drills. So if we back it up to blanket into an escort position, okay, I could turn him or, you know, to face the camera, or if I just ended up here, I can use this down here. I've already got him going down. I can use this to start him going down to the ground, or use it to take him all the way to the ground. Okay? I could use the same thing, and again, I can do that as a drill each time. I can drag him down. I can step and drag him down. Another option would be, as I'm dragging him down, I can just reach over and take it into a figure four. One, two, pass, blanket escort, 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 wrist lock. One, two, pass, blanket escort, wrist lock. One, two, pass, blanket escort, take the arm, work the arm, okay? Over the top, work the arm. One, two, blanket escort, take the elbow one way, take the elbow over the top the other way. Now, one other option that we have, from one of our previous videos that we worked on with our six basic knife attacks, the same thing can be put into these drills with just a few minor changes because of that weapon. Okay, as an example, one, two, pass, blanket escort, okay, and I can still work on that limb destruction. Okay, now the difference would be I want to stay, now in this case I passed it to where I've gotten to the outside position, I'm outside his arm, which is where I'd want to be. Much better than inside position because he's still got a lot of other things that he can go after me with. So the difference that we would make is that we get to a position with whatever we're doing, three count, four count, passing, we get to the outside. So number one, block pass, block check, pass. Now, if I'm coming down here, whichever combination I'm using, slide down, okay, disarm or wrist lock, or just going here, or just going here, okay? Two, I'm already in that position. So the same thing, I can be sliding and just building it up. Three, okay, the same thing with my three count, I could be doing the same combination, okay? Four, I'm already on the outside, so I could still be doing that same, the exact same combination, okay? Five, still the exact same thing. Six, still the exact combination, whatever I wanted to build that to. If I wanted to just do one, two, and pass it and get to the outside, one, and I'm on the outside. If I wanted to make it a little bit farther, one, two, pass and drag down, 3. I'm on the outside, so I just drag down. So you can build those up with the numbers, you know, all our different basic 6 attacks with the knife, and do the same drills, use it to build up step by step. But the whole purpose of these was, again, first to recognize that, again, as we mentioned, you might have a weapon. You might not have a weapon. I mean, if you do have one, it might be a blade, it might be a stick, might be short, long, different sized. They might have a weapon. They might not have a weapon. If they do have one, it might be short, long, heavy, you know, all different things. But what you're trying to think of, you know, a lot of times people that are studying the Philippine martial arts think that you're teaching the stick, you're learning a stick, you're learning a knife. What you're doing is you're trying to educate your body. You're educating your hands and your arms to go in certain directions, to respond to certain attacks from certain angles or certain areas. If there's something in your hand, great, those moves will work. If there's not something in your hand, if done properly, transitioning, those techniques should still work. If there's something, a weapon in his hand, those techniques should work. If there isn't a weapon in his hand is the weapon, and transitioning, those techniques should still be able to work. So remember, you're not educating the weapon. You're educating your hands, your arms, yourself. So building up those combinations, little by little, step by step, repeating, and then changing, and then you know, moving forward, backward, in circles, you're building up your ability to react in different ways. Because remembering that the purpose of the drills and the practicing is not to get perfect on the drills. The purpose of the drills is to get it so your body can respond with certain moves in different areas, different angles, at any time without thinking about it. So if the drill is not perfect, that's not the main purpose. You want to do the drill as good as you can until your body can perform smoothly. But every situation is not the same. So when you get better and better, what you'll find is you may not do it exactly the way the drill is, but you'll make it work. And that's the whole purpose, is not to get perfect on the drills, but to get it to the point where when things change, you can still adapt to them and make your techniques work in those different situations. Many martial arts styles have some type of short impact weapon that they use. It might be used for control, but most people use them in some type of self-defense situation, breaking locks and striking. Okay, and they make very effective tools. They're small, they're easier to carry, especially when you can't have anything bigger. Philippine martial arts, there's several different names for them. Other martial arts, there's names. This is the pointed both ends. Could be called a dulo-dulo or a lisi-palat or a pasak. Several different names, short stick, pocket stick, there's different types, edges on them. Kubatons, basically the same thing, used as keychains, short impact. Again, usually it's something just long enough that you can make a tighter fist, maybe, you know, a little bit stronger fist, and you can hit with the two ends, okay? And the, which you can do with all of these things. Also, some of the other commercially made products and stuff are on these with the same idea, okay? Wooden keychain, Kubaton type thing. And this one's pointed at one end, keys on the other. Advantages to these are with your keys on them is you're in a parking lot, you're walking around, they're always in your hand. Okay, this one has points on, so would be a little bit different for striking, for punching. Now, what we're going to be doing with these first is going through some different ways that you can use these as an impact tool. Easiest way, simplest way. And putting in with, again, with matching with some of the training that we've already been doing. As an introduction to the striking, we put together a couple of sets so you can practice just getting used to actually swinging the sets, okay? The first one, we've got a set of 10 that we use to remind people that you can still punch with this in your hand. Tighter fist, you know, and it's going to be just as effective. You can still do it so you don't lose things. So it's a punch, and then coming straight down, backhanding, then hitting behind you, so you get used to directions, down, hitting low. Then a figure eight towards the front. Then you're coming in towards the side of the head, swinging backwards again, somebody behind you, coming up, and then coming up using that thumb strike behind you. Okay, so in order to practice on those, again, just a little bit, that first set would be punching, down, backhand, low. Figure eight, thumb in, hammer back, swing it up with the thumb side and back. On the other side, punch, down, backhand, low. Figure eight, thumb in, hammer back, thumb up, thumb side back. Second set that we would be using, again, just short, just so to put in the basics of hitting with this. Again, we're using the butt end of this now, is just coming in once high, and that target could be anywhere. The head, the hand, the arm, if it's out, up high on the chest, it's just coming in about a 45 degree angle. Okay, so that would be one, and then high, low, and then you're coming in from your strong side and your reaction side, and then one, two, three, you add on that third one, down low. So again, that's one, high, low, strong side, reaction side, okay? And then one, two, three. That would be the basis, you know, your basic striking with the palm stick. Jenny's going to be going through some of the basic strikes. And again, we'll give you know some idea on different angles and things you can use. The main thing is it doesn't take a lot of training. It doesn't have to be perfect. It's just a matter of swinging and hitting, you know, your targets with this. Okay? So first of all, if you're working on just one, okay, you still got the other hand that you can use. But different things you can be using with this, as I mentioned before, with anything in your hand, you're usually going to have a tighter fist. So you can still be punching. Okay, and you're going to be punching a little more effectively because of the tighter fist and the weight that's in it. You could be using like a hammer fist, hammer strikes, okay, coming down almost like you're stabbing with that side. And again, the same thing if you were sideways or backwards, it would be real easy to swing, okay, from different angles. Turn around, okay, to swing, hit from different angles. The other thing would be using your thumb side, okay, thumb side to strike with, because that's where the other end is sticking out, okay? Ribs, bones, you know, abdomen, neck, head, eyes, fingers. Also using it as a blocking tool, okay? Because if you're striking arms, leading with that, if you hit with the weapon, it's going to cause a lot of damage to the smaller bones. If you miss with the weapon, you'll probably still be blocking with your forearm, and you still have that on there. So some of the things we did before, as an example, on our three counts, where it was primary block, check and counter, primary, use your long, check and counter. So your three counts to striking with, okay? Somebody's reaching, okay? Or somebody is swinging, using that to hit with. Now, if you block with it, fine. If not, as long as it's blocked, again, it still works, okay? You can be coming, you know, again, different targets, different ways of doing that. Okay, go left forward. Okay, she's still got her checking hand out. Remember, as I mentioned before, this hand still works. So this one can be attacking, you know, example, can be going high, punching, okay, using that hammer strike, coming down on either side across a figure eight motion. Okay, a figure eight could be coming to my head. It could be coming towards my shoulders. If my arms were out, it could be used in a blocking motion. If one arm was out, it could be used to smash it both directions. So there's a lot of, you know, I mean, very simple, very easy if you know just your basic striking, punching, using your thumb, using your hammer. We went through on three counts on there. Next thing would be, I had a stationary target. I would stand here, and she's just going to walk and move a little bit, working on striking. Okay, working striking first, looking at different target areas. Again, that you're not choosing the position you end up with. So you might be sideways, you might be backwards, you might be towards the person's right side, left side, and then working in her trapping hand like she's starting to do. She can use that to keep me back to keep me checked. She can also use that to add on in her striking. Okay, then the same thing, we're going this way. Now I can start moving too and start giving her a moving target. Reaching and giving her different target areas. Okay, different positions for her to strike at. So she's not thinking, you know, just in a set pattern. She's just thinking about hitting, okay, about hitting anything that's out there. Okay, next step, as far as your basic striking, would be actually making contact, hitting something. So we're going to be using pads. As I mentioned, the next step would be actually hitting something. So the choices would be either if I would be padded enough on the body, groin, head, arms preferably, then she could be targeting on those things and actually hitting. Now, barring that protection, then I could be using pads. Now, what she'll be doing is, again, with some of the strikes, so basic strikes, okay, go ahead. Okay, now, just repeat the same strike a couple of times, so we'll start punching. As I mentioned, she can be punching with it. Okay, she can be using that hammer strike. She can be hitting different angles. Okay, simulating up high by my neck, by my face. She could be hitting backwards, down low, up higher. I could be doing combinations. Okay, and then I can just start giving a couple of opposing targets. Remember that she's got her punches, she's got her thumbs. She's got the hammer. She can be doing anything. And basically now I want to be moving around and I'll give her a couple. Okay, and let her move. And I'll give her a couple. Or I'll change her position. Turn around. Okay. Two or three times and then step away and turn back again. Okay. Got one each time. Okay. Once more, and then keep going. And next step then is where she's going to be starting to work in her other hand. And if I had more on the pads, well, the easiest way is if I had leg protection or bigger pads, we could be starting to work in kicks along with the hands and the elbows. Okay, and with the impact weapon, with the palm stick. Okay, so there's a lot of different things, and again, they're not hard. It's simple. You're making use of your basic angles. If all you had was just a backhand, your hammer strike, your thumb strike, and your punch, those three things alone can be put into a lot of easy, simple combinations. And the same thing would be working if somebody had a hold. You know, starting to work on, if you had a release here, using it to twist off and strike that, if I had that hand to strike, or if somebody's grabbing on the other side, again, real basic things from self-defense programs now, if it's any grab anywhere else, using that to strike, damage that arm, and move them off, or using on the same side to hammer and strike, and to be able to continue. So going again with the impact weapons, with different weapons, and working that in with our empty hands and with the edge weapons, everything else, a lot of the skills are similar in your striking, your angles. And what we've been trying to say is it's not just the drill, it's not just the weapon, but it's the ability to move in certain directions, certain angles. And if there happens to be something in your hand, great. It might be edged, it might be impact. It might be a short tool like a palm stick. It might be something a little bit longer, a lot longer. But if you're working on the same angles, the same ideas, the same concepts, you've got a good chance of being successful with any of these things you're picking up. Okay? Now, next thing is we'll be showing a couple other drills with these, using them for control. So using the pocket stick as a control tool. Now another option with the pocket stick or palm stick is being able to use this for control. Maybe you haven't decided to strike people yet. So, I mean, it does work having this little tool. Now, this I'm using a smaller one here because this is a little more like the regular keychain that you could be using. But again, because this is an inanimate object and very hard, strong, whether they're made out of plastic, wood, metal, aluminum, they can cause a lot more pain than I could cause just by squeezing my own flesh and blood, my hands. So, Kayla, come on in. Again, going through these, we'll go through a little bit slower on each one, but this would be, I don't want to hit him yet. I just want to control him or keep him off balance. So what we're doing is we're moving in, and we're doing going to what we call a blanket position on his elbow, because I'm starting control here. Then I'm sliding down, so I've got his wrist, and I'm stretched his arm out, taking out the slack. This is what we call an escort position. Okay, now the first thing, depending on how much, you know, degree of control I want or how much, what degree of pain I want to cause him, is just very easy to call a thumb squeeze. You're just going to slide it down, just put it on the back of their thumb because it's the easiest place to reach on bone, and basically you just squeeze, okay? Squeeze the object, okay, the stick against the bone. Now the next thing, maybe if I wanted to take him right down to the ground, is I'm going to put it on the thumb side of his forearm, right on the bone. Now this particular one has ridges. Some might have grooves cut into it or different types of design that work even better on here. But I'm going to put that right on the thumb side on the bone. I'm going to take, basically there's two different grips we would use of this. One would be like a C grip. The other one, you're just making a total clamp out of it, okay, with whatever you're squeezing in between. So a C grip usually for pressure or a full clamp. Now I'm going to move this up. I'm going to make a full clamp by grabbing onto it with a finger of the other hand so I can keep pressure on, keep from getting away. I'm going to step forward about a 45 degree angle. This we call it's just a wrist drop, okay, or a drag down. I'm going to step out at a 45 degree angle. I use the stick to turn the thumb down and grind against the bone. As I step forward, I lean him forward and I drag him down onto the ground. Now, once he's onto his stomach, then I can just move in to one of the a double knee drop or one of the other control areas. Okay? So that would just be a wrist drag. Now, if I don't want to take him down right away, I'm just going to back that up. Again, I went from blanket and an escort position. Okay? Now, I can use the thumb side or the hammer side for pressure. What I'm going to do this first time is I've got his palm towards me. That exposes the radial nerve up on the mound of his forearm. I'm going to use the hammer side, and I'm going to just put that in using my body as a brace so that it's not just causing pain out here. I've got it braced. I can cause more pain, and I can control it. So I put the hammer side into the mound of that forearm, which is the radial nerve, and I just dig it in, okay, to cause pain there. Now, I take my C grip, turn his thumb up a little bit, and I'm going to use the stick at the inside of his elbow, which is his ulnar nerve. There I've got my C grip. The stick is on the nerve. My thumb is on the back side of his arm, bracing it. And I can use this on the ulnar nerve to cause a degree of pain. I can slide it up, hit the same nerve between the bicep and tricep, the exact same grip to cause pain. Okay, so that's the ulnar nerve at the elbow or the upper arm. Now, if I want to get him more off balance, okay, I can put this into his floating rib with the thumb side. Basically, all I'm doing is floating ribs as I'm tickling him, but, you know, causing a degree of discomfort, okay, and pushing him away so he's off balance. So if it's person's trying to come in or something, I can keep moving him away to keep him off balance. Now, keeping on using this for pressure, okay, I'm going to turn him around here so you can see. Now, I'm going to still use that C grip, but now what I'm going to do is I'm turning my palm up, and I'm going to first, after the floating ribs I just hit, I'm going to his lat tricep connection, the rear of the armpit. I'm going to use, with my palm up, I put it in, so I've got the back flap of the armpit. I use my thumb in the back, and I squish and pinch here. So it's a lat tricep pinch. Now, if I want a little more distance, or if I miss this, I don't have a good grip, then all I'm going to do is I'm just going to straighten it out, and I'm going to push it into the center of the armpit, okay? And just push in, and again, just like I did on the floating ribs, push him away, keep him off balance. Now, I've got him stretched out. I've got his arm in extension and weaker. I'm going to go up to the trap. I'm going to turn my palm down, again, using that C grip. I put my thumb in front of his trap, trapezius muscle, in his shoulder. I put the stick in the back using that C grip, and I pinch. Okay, so again, I can take his balance, I can buckle him down. That might be enough for control, depending on the degree of resistance that he's putting up. Now that I've got him off balance here, I can roll him down. I'm going to go into an arm bar. Okay, so all I'm going to do is above his elbow, I use my arm, step forward my outside foot, and I'm going to roll the elbow and bring him forward. So if we're doing this as a set, basically I have the lat tricep into the armpit, I had the trap, and if that's not doing it, I just roll it into an arm bar, stepping forward my outside foot. Now, then one of the next ones is a snake circle. Same thing we use a lot with knife disarms and stick disarms in the Filipino martial arts. I'm going to come around from the outside. As I'm going to make a circle, I'm going to bend his arm and come down. Okay, this is what we call a snake circle. What I'm doing is I've got a wrist lock. I put my arm, my forearm, at his elbow joint, and I use the bend. As I bend his arm, that puts pressure down on the pocket stick, which is in the top of his shoulder. So there's the snake circle again. As I'm doing this from the outside, doing it smooth, bend the elbow, bend his arm, bend his wrist, and put pressure straight down. Okay, and from this side, that would have been right here. Now I'm going to use the hammer side, the hammer end, go around his head while I keep this arm bent, and I'm going to roll his head down, bring him down onto his back briefly, take his balance out, put him onto his back. As soon as that's done, I'm going to pull him onto his stomach, bring his hand towards his lower back, and again, I can choose if I want to come into a double knee drop or any other method of securing his arm behind his back for control. And the back of his ribs, lower area, back of the kidney, anything else, if I do have to cause any more control, or his wrist, or his wrist, or the thumb, fingers, I still got a lot of options there. So basically that head turn down, come on this side. If I started with that snake circle, and I'm going to lever the head lever, roll him down, drag him over, and then move in for control. Okay? Come on here. Now, a couple other ones. One would be from the back, if I'm just approaching, just call this a chest drop. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use the hammer side in the upper pec clavicle area. Okay? That hand is going to go over the top. The other arm is going underneath, because I want to use two hands on here. I'm going to pull them in tight. So I go over with the weapon hand, under with the other hand. I'm going to cross over, use the hammer side, take a two-handed grip. I'm putting my pressure in the direction I want him to go. So I'm not going this way. I'm putting pressure down and back. So I keep him snugged up, okay, so I don't leave any slack where he's going to fall and get released. I brace him. I use this to wiggle in, take his balance. I lean back, bring him down, and then all I have to do is just use the same weapon hand, hook his arm, and roll him over, and again, move in for control. That's just a chest drop. And the other option with that is a push-pull. Okay, I'm in the front, and I want to do that chest drop. So what I'd be doing then is I use the thumb side to that same area, and I'm going to push that side. As I'm moving in, I push his left shoulder as I grab and pull his right shoulder. So it's a push-pull at the same time. So I'm moving in, push-pull. Then all I have to do is reverse my hand, and I'm back to the same spot I just was. Pull him in, take his balance, drop him down, hook him over, and move in. Okay? So these would give some of the easier available options that you can use this pocket stick or palm stick for control. So today, by going into the empty-handed skills and a little bit more of the trapping, blocking, and the small tool, the small stick, pocket stick, palm stick, We try to put a little bit more glue in between the other things that we've been introducing up to this point. Because again, it's not any one thing, long stick, knife, whatever it is. It's your knowledge, it's being able to use whatever you have to, especially with weapons training. It's being able to pick up and use whatever you have to, or not, if that's all you have, being able to use those things. But being able to use them with the same concepts, the same ideas. And today should have given a little bit more understanding of some of those other things that puts it together. Again, I just want to remind people that even though most of this today, with most of our videos, we've been doing what you might consider more dangerous things, you know, with the edged weapons and the longer sticks and the heavier sticks and the double sticks. And, you know, it might seem that because this was only this little stick or empty hands that you don't have to worry about it as much when you're training or practicing. We want to stress that with anything we did, you can still damage yourself or, more likely, your partners, the people you practice with. So again, stressing that training videos shouldn't be used by a beginner just as your total learning. You should be using this under the instruction of a qualified instructor, someone that can lead you through, make sure you're doing the training right, the drills right, make sure you're getting the most benefit out of your practice. They'll be able to watch more. You can watch yourself in a mirror and say, yeah, this looks close. But chances are an instructor will be able to tell you, you know, that foot should be turning a little bit more. Instead of here, you should be aiming maybe an inch lower, or, you know, just turn your hand a little bit more. So they're going to pick up a lot more things that you're not used to looking at. So for safety's sake and for your learning as fast and efficiently as possible, you know, make sure that you know what you're doing. Don't practice indiscriminately and hurt other people, your animals, you know, et cetera, at home by practicing these. So use these, hopefully enhance your other martial arts skills, and hopefully we'll see you with the other videos.